I was trying to reflect on what our, how our presentations, any high presentation, how it is complementing our other two presenters. And what I was noticing is that we are probably in the initial stages of doing, getting ready to do some research. And so what you're going to see is how I think we're going in a direction. In fact, you'll see it in our presentation of this idea of distributed, we're calling it resilience, but leadership, and sometimes the idea of maybe relational, that leadership has to do with collaborative kind of situation. So as we start going, should be in Barcelona.
Thanks for leaving me up here. Technology load.
Okay, now, three things before, as we get started. First, I am just at the end of a pinhole, so you're going to notice that I'm getting feedback from my nose and my head and my ears. So if I check out a little bit as we're going through, I apologize for that. The second thing, Eddie and I are in Antioch University's PhD program in leadership and change, whose emphasis is on practitioner research. One of the things that you're going to see as we go through this presentation, you're going to see Eddie and my journey into developing what we hope to be an idea of practitioner research. Third thing, as we start, I would like you to think about your organization, whatever organization that you're in. What type of risks are there? To begin, in January, we submitted a paper that was developing a concept that we call strategic social capital. Strategic social capital was an idea of integrating social capital, corporate social responsibility, social networking, and through the vehicle of boundary spanning. This here is the initial framework that we came up with. What, since that time, our thinking has evolved, and we've come to a point now that we want to present today what we're calling distributed resilience, which is the next iteration of what we're thinking is this corporate or this strategic social capital idea. And then, so we're going to take you through what we think it is. Boulder, Colorado, 2013, over an 8-day span, somewhere in the neighborhood of 17 inches of rain fell in the Boulder area, decimating the downtown. This is one of the main streets in Boulder, destroying over 550 structures and causing over $1 billion damage to the area. This becomes kind of what we call a tale of two organizations. Both of these organizations were not directly affected by the flood water. Company A sent out an email to all of its employees stating to them, stay home, be safe, protect your families first. Company B didn't send any communication to the employees, and it didn't seem like that they even acknowledged that there was a disaster unfolding.
So, Larry, again, first and foremost, as an ex-military person, any leader that keeps a bar open for 2 hours is a great leader. So the question we have for you is, which organization do you feel exhibited? How many of you think Company A exhibited more resilience? So we believe that they both exhibited some level of resilience. According to Walker and Salk, Company A probably experienced what they refer to as general resilience, which is the capacity to absorb disturbances of any kind. We believe Company B exhibited a specified type of resilience. But beyond that, we also recognize that inaction sometimes can be resilience. But furthermore, as we looked at this, we started to think that this might be a hierarchical sort of approach to resilience. And we have just a bit of a problem. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to build on the idea of general resilience and specified resilience to create a type of resilience that would spread across an organization, through all levels of the organization, develop this idea of resilience thinking and resilience practices in order to mitigate the effects of a natural disaster. So this is kind of the goal that we had as we started going down this road. The boundaries that we came up with, we have the macro, the meso, and the micro. Now, what we are looking to do, as we said before, build resilience by developing sense-making practices, and we're putting them in what we call, that's the relational domain. And also what we have come to term adaptive practices, which we said are the adaptive domain, which are the networking and the idea of complex adaptive systems that run within organizations.
We used Holly and Gunderson's graphic of a complex system from their book Panarchy, and we did that solely to remind ourselves that we have to be cognizant of the fact that this is a system that's in flux. This is a system that's the organization and the entities constantly emerging, and so we wanted to understand that any feedback that comes from the organization is going to be feedback that is not going to be static. So how do we define resilience? Well, we tend to like this definition by Walker and Salk. The ability to absorb disturbance and still retain its basic function and structure. However, we do find a problem with the latter portion of this definition, retaining its basic function and structure. So a lot of times what you'll find in the literature is a definition that says the organization will bounce back. But what if the organization could, rather than bouncing back, leap forward and have a different identity? Is that possible? And that's part of our inquiry. So we thought that two domains would be very relevant to that conversation.
The relational domain is kind of the domain that I'm heading in the direction as I'm doing my work toward my dissertation. We're kind of, at one point we called it the cognitive domain as well. With the idea of sense-making within an organization and developing what we are thinking about is this idea of a collaborative sense-making mindset throughout the organization.
And so from my side, what I was hoping to do is look at what we're calling the adaptive domain. And this is really primarily about how do the networks, the social capital that exists, how do they mobilize to then create synergy during times of disruption, which is almost exactly what you guys were describing that happened in your experience. So,
here's where our next iteration, we thought that the relational domain plus the adaptive domain created this new thing that we're at this point calling distributed resilience, something that stretches across throughout an organization in times of destruction, disasters to possibly mitigate.
So we started working with, we define distributed resilience the best we can. And right now our understanding of distributed resilience is the resilience that extends the boundaries of management disruption to include the understanding that people are complex, but also systems are complex. And the nature of those systems are always going to have multiple perspectives. And there's our working definition. So, but then we had to sort of visualize this thing. And we struggled doing that. And so we took to YouTube, which everybody does, figure things out.
And everybody wants puppies.
I love them.
So here we have a disruption. That disruption is milk. And then what we have is the emergence of behavior. And that behavior is something we are hoping to sort of figure out as an organization. And it's a great example of not only distributed resilience, but also what a complex adaptive system does, which they emerge into something, some symbiotic behavior. And so the next line is just a reminder of where our initial framework was when we started this journey. And so because we knew we had to tighten this up for academia, we couldn't just use the puppies and apologize. We created what we have today.
Calling our mobilizing framework. Now, it is rather busy, but what I would like you to just to take you through just kind of the major side of it. To look at the left-hand side, the relational domain really focuses on more of the relational leadership, possibly, and decision-making processes that go on in an organization. And on the other side, we have the adaptive, on the right side, domain that really focuses on networking, bridging, linking, and developing those practices. And if you see the arrows pointing in toward the organization, those are the boundary-spanning practices that that go on within an organization that we're hoping to develop as well. All of that integrated into the micro, meso, relational practices that we're hoping to, this is where we're going, our research tends to be going, is to look at relational practices that develop collaborative sense-making and a sense-giving mindset among organizational levels, and adaptive practices that develop bridging and linking practices within networks throughout the organization.
So then this is the biggest question. What does it all mean? And we're hoping to figure some of this out, but what we can say is the short answer is that given our looming challenges as a global community, maybe creating a distributed resilience model would be helpful in just approaching resilience from any perspective. And so what we ask you to do, what we invite you to do, is that go back and look at what your current challenges are in your organization and consider the future of your organization in this context. Thank you.
So when will your research be finished?
Tomorrow.